start our Sunday school. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank and praise you for another opportunity just to be here, Lord, to be in your house and to hear your word, Lord, through the teaching and the preaching. And Lord, I just ask that you be in the midst today. You're welcome in and bless all that's said and done in your name. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. It's beautiful, isn't it? I had my mind on the Eagles this week, so that's where we're going. It'd probably be a little bit different than what we've been into, but that's okay. It's all God's word. So, eagle-like Christians, if everybody has a paper, there's a couple, I think everybody in here has one. Eagle-like Christians. Isaiah 40 and 31, and this is the scripture that stayed with me, that I, one of my favorites. It's very well known, but Isaiah 40 and 31 says, "But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint." And that scripture in itself says a lot. So when you think about eagles, and you think there in Isaiah that the Lord compares us to eagles, so I think it'd be good to go over some characteristics of the eagle so we can learn. So on your next page there, characteristics and qualities of eagles. How does it compare to us? Number one, eagles have powerful vision. Two, eagles are fearless. Three, eagles are tenacious. Four, eagles are high flyers. And five, eagles nurture their young. Eagles have powerful vision. It's one of the main things about eagles. Every time you pull something up, that's what they talk about. You know, eagles sitting high on a cliff or a tree, they watch closely. They're very attentive. How many in here has been within, let's say, 10 feet of an eagle? A couple of you, okay. I haven't. I know my mom said one time she was riding with somebody and they hit like a low line by a little stream and this eagle flew towards them. And she said, "I'd never realized how big they were." And she said that, you know, it came towards the car and the eagle span was wider than the hood of the car. And that she never forgot that, how close it came and how much of a, you know, she got to see it. They're beautiful creatures, but the Lord compares them to us. So what can we learn from them? Their vision is very powerful. The eyes of the eagle are especially designed for long-distance focus with clarity. And while we go through these, put on your spiritual mind and think about it. The eagle's eye is one of the strongest in the entire animal kingdom, 4 to 8 times stronger than the average human. An eagle is able to spot a rabbit 2 miles away. An eagle's eyes are roughly the same size of a human. In fact, an eagle descends to attack its prey. The muscles in its eyes continually adjust to the curvature of the eyeball in order to maintain a sharp focus throughout the approach and the attack. Their eyes are stated to be larger in size than their brain. The most noteworthy feature of eagle's eyes are color vision, high resolution, and clarity. So, starting out, you know, we say that the lion is the king of the jungle, the eagle is the king of the air. Is this wrong? Mm-hmm. do. They use the same nest. And they keep adding, yes. Yeah, and they can get huge. They support a lot. So what can we learn from eagles and take it and apply it to our spiritual walk? Powerful vision. Like it said, 4 to 8 times better than the human can spot a rabbit 2 miles away. Eagles have the ability to see prey, even their fish underwater. Through water, they can see. Their eyes lock in on their prey, and they descend down to catch it. And the eagles also, it didn't say in that other part, they can fly 75 to 100 mile an hour. That's fast. That is a quick, that is quick to adjust to something as small as a fish. If you think about, they can be 2 miles up, they can see a fish underwater, and their eyes will adjust. And if you're flying 100 mile an hour, their eyes adjust that quick to the fish. So they have to adjust quickly. They stay locked in on what is needed to nourish itself. Just as us, we should have our eyes and our hearts locked on the things of God, on His Word. We should be able to lock our focus. Yeah. Right. It is very amazing. Their vision is unbelievable. It really is. And they see better than any other bird, you know. And I think there's a lot of reasons why the Lord used the eagle in reference. That's a long distance. Get your eyes focused on things of God and searching for a plan and what you need to sustain you, just like the bird, the eagle does, looking for something to sustain him. And he gets locked in, and that's what we have to do. And also how he locks in on the prey and nothing else distracts him. You know, he can see that rabbit 2 miles away and there could be other things moving. He don't get distracted. Their eyes lock in almost like how they have the direction missiles that will lock in, you know, on something incoming and it'll stay on it. Their eyes are the same way. They lock in on their prey and they don't look any other way. So don't get our eyes on things to the left and to the right. As the end time nears, our vision needs to be sharp. Our vision needs to be locked in and focused like never before if we're going to make it through. We have to be able to see clearly in this end time because there's going to be a lot of things coming and going, and there already is, but it's going to get worse. We have to be clear and focused on what we're doing and what the goal is. Another thing that added was that eagles see through camouflage, so they can actually spot animals hidden under leaves and brush, where other animals, animals have instinct, they go and hide if something's up trying to catch it, but the eagle can see through the camouflage and spot animals hidden underneath leaves and brush. How does that apply to us? Well, as Christians, we should be able to spot what is real and what is not. We should have the discernment to know what is of God and what is earthly. Just as that eagle is looking down and sees things all around, you know, a pile of leaves it can see and know that living thing is under there. It's what it needs. We should be able to spot what is real and what is not. Baby eagles, whose eyes are not completely mature yet, will sometimes go after different things, plastic bottles, trash, things like that. The baby eagles, as their eyes are starting to mature, they'll go after those things. Well, you know, we're all eagles, and there's different stages, just like there is, you know, baby eagles, eaglets. As Christians, we start out as baby eagles. We must grow in the Lord. If you don't grow, if you stay the same and you don't mature, you will go after something that sounds good and looks good, but it isn't real. So it's important that we, once you get saved, that you keep going forward. And no matter what age you are or how long you've been saved, you can always grow. Because like I said, that baby eagle will go after, you know, think that it sees something, sees a plastic bottle and it thinks that it's food. And it'll go after it, but it's nothing for it. It's useless. So we have to be careful what we set our affections on, what we're focused on what we're trying to get. Make sure it's the real thing. Make sure that it's something that is going to sustain you. And even it may not be like a bad thing, but it could be something to distract you from what, you know, you may be chasing a plastic bottle when the real prey is right over way and what you really need. Proverbs 29 and 18 says, where there is no vision, the people perish. We must have a vision for our lives and take steps necessary to fulfill it. No matter our age, you have to have goals and visions in the Lord. We never stop growing. You know, God doesn't look at age like we look at age. You know, we think, okay, we hit 60, you know, I'm retired, I'm not going to do anything. The Lord doesn't look at it that way. He wants us to keep working. As long as you're physically able, and even if you're not physically able, you're able to pray. You're still able to do things for the Lord. Like the eagle that soars high, we must always be searching for ways to strengthen our walk with God. Ways to push ourselves to read more, to study more, to pray, just to commune with Him, and allow yourself to be led of the Spirit to see what God has for you. Finally, there are another fact about eagles. Their eyes are so complex, and this is the one I found very fascinating. Their eyes are so complex that they are able to look directly into the sun without any damage to their eyes. That says a mouthful right there. It really does. Put your spiritual eyes on, caps on this morning. They can look directly into the sun, and it does not damage their eyes. And all the other birds, if they look at the sun, they get disoriented. But the eagle does not. The osprey, which is very close to the eagle, it is in size. It's one of the eagle's, adversaries. I'll use that word. But they fight a lot with eagles. They compete for territory a lot. And they're pretty big as well. The osprey, which shares a lot of the same habitat with the eagle, is the only other bird that will attempt to challenge an eagle. They will usually only do this on the ground. But if they do challenge them in the air, the eagle will fly towards the sun. The osprey loses sight of the eagle in the sun rays, in the brilliance of the sun, and the eagle will escape. So what does this tell us to do? Obviously, when we are in trouble, and our enemy comes to challenge us in our territory, we have to fly to the sun, the S-O-N. Don't fight your adversary. Fly towards the sun. And I thought that was fascinating. Side note, eagles often raid the nest of osprey and eat the eggs of the young. So an eagle will find an osprey nest and eat the young. And if you think about that in the spiritual, they're being on the offense, you know, of something that's later on going to come against them or their young. So they'll go eat the young or the osprey. Definitely rivals. Yep. All right. Jump back to your paper. On number two, eagles are fearless hunters. An eagle will never surrender to its prey, no matter its strength or size. It will always put up a fight to win its prey or reign in territory, its territory. Golden eagles are such remarkable hunters that they can prey on goats much larger than them by throwing them off the side of a cliff. We can learn a lot from an eagle's determination. The talons or claws of an eagle's toes are curved or razor sharp for catching and holding prey. These large toes gave eagles their name raptor, which comes from a Latin word meaning rapere, which means to grip or to grasp. The rough-like bumps on the eagle's toes help them to hold slippery, wiggly prey like fish. I thought about that. How do they hold on to them, slippery fish? You know, but they have, you know, just like you go buy gloves, non-slip gloves with bumps on them, they have that on their feet. It's amazing and fascinating how the Lord equipped them, give them exactly what they need to survive. Their diet consists of mainly fish, but water fowl and small animals. And it's a known fact that eagles will not eat anything already dead, not like other birds, you know, the the buzzards and things like that, they'll eat dead. An eagle will only eat fresh. They will not eat anything that's dead. They have to kill it, and then they'll eat it. So leave the dead things alone. You know, seek, and, you know, there's a lot in that as well as far as seeking the Lord for fresh. You know, what we need to sustain us, we need fresh. We need fresh word. And I still have a little bit of notes on flying. Eagles fly higher than any other bird. And interesting fact I read, too, that eagles are not afraid of storms. While other birds will take cover, eagles are not afraid of storms. In fact, it says some people who've studied them says they seemingly enjoy them. And they will, when the storm comes, they won't hide. They won't usually take cover. They'll fly. They fly in it and seem to enjoy it. And as Christians, we must be able to stay close to God as possible, stay high as possible to the Lord. And when a storm does come, the eagles will fly high in the storm to take themselves high, and they will go as high as they can in the sky. And then they will use the wind to carry them. You will see other birds, like if you've ever seen bats, if you've ever seen like a something, you'll see bats, and they flap and they flap and they flap. And you see other birds, they're trying to gain, they flap and they flap. An eagle uses the wind. They don't, you know, very, you'll see them flap when they're low catching, but they go up high. They go higher than any other bird, and they let the wind carry them. Yeah. It might. They use them like as a glide. And it's fascinating. Their wingspan is, I think I read, 7 to 9 feet wide is the average. And then you have some that are more. But that is a wide glide right there. But, their wings, you know, while you're in the, and think about that when you're in a storm, how easy it is to just flap your wings and try to gain momentum and try to weather and go in this direction and that direction. It must be very tiring. You know, we get tired of flapping our wings sometimes in the storms. But if we just fly high to the Lord and we let him carry us in the wind, and the wind of the eagles representing our faith and belief in God. So what I challenge you today, whatever storm you're going through, no matter how hard the storm is raging, let the storm carry you higher and closer to God. Don't struggle to fight it. Use it. You know, the eagles use it to their advantage. Spread your wings and let the Lord carry you through. And I thought about that in the Bible. Satan often comes as storms to try to come against the Christians, like the disciples in the boat and different things. He uses storms to come against each and every one of us. Everybody's storm is different. You know, and what may be hard for one may not be hard for another, but Satan knows, and he knows what storm to send your way to throw you off. But if we do like the eagle and we just go as close as we can, we fly as high as we can above the storm, and then just let the wind carry us, stay in the Lord, and just let it, you know, you'll ride through the storm. Go to number 3. Yeah, you stay calm. It's hard, you know, you're in a storm. You want to try to fix it and get it over quickly. None of us, it's uncomfortable to be in the middle of a storm, any type of storm. You don't want to go through it, you know, but the Lord says we're going to, you know, and so you're gonna have to go through them. And it's sometimes I think we repeat the same storms because we don't learn the first time. You know, it's like he wants you just fly above it as close to him, just like that eagle. Go above the storm. and then just ride it out in, you know, with your wings. Number three, eagles are tenacious defenders. Watch an eagle when a storm comes. While other birds fly away from the storm, the eagle spreads its mighty wings and uses the current to soar to greater heights. The eagle takes advantage of the very storm that the lesser birds fear. And, you know, sometimes these storms that come are to teach us something. We don't welcome them because we don't like them, but we really should, because if the Lord sends it your way, or he allows it, let me say it that way, if he allows it to come your way, there's something in it that he wants you to learn. He wants to try to advance you. Bald eagles use their long, sharp claws to defend themselves. Bald eagles do not have any animal predators, like I said, the osprey. A large bird may try to attack them, but the eagle will scare them away. They usually don't try, but those are the only ones that ever get the guts to try. Eagles build their nest high up and are vigilant protectors of their eggs and young. It is thought that the bald eagles mate for life. However, if one member of the pair dies or disappears, the survivor will choose a new mate. So I thought that was interesting that they stay with the same one, you know, just like the Lord says we should do. Stay with the same one, you know. If one dies, okay, and find another. But it's, you know, that's what he said. They invest heavily in their relationships. They share the burden of building and maintaining a home and the trials of parenthood. They both do it together. Eagle courtship involves elaborate, spectacular calls and flight displays. Usually a territory defended by a mature pair will be 1 to 2 kilometers, or like one little over a mile, of waterside habitat. And they do, from what I read, it says a lot of that the eagles mate in the air. Thought that was pretty neat, but they both work together. It says that the mother, the female and the male will bring the things for the nest, twigs and different things that they use, and they will both bring them, but the female intertwines them and makes them. And then they both feed the young. And like I also read that most birds, as you know, will, it's kind of gross, but you know, they'll get food and then they chew it, swallow it, regurgitate it to the babies. The eagle doesn't do that. They feed them fresh meat. So there's a difference there. We always got to have fresh. Got to have fresh. And that's like us. Number four, eagles are high flyers. Great leaders are problem solvers. They don't like to complain like the chickens do. When a storm comes, they love to take challenges as the eagle does. In reality, eagles tend to use very little energy when they fly. When they're flying that high, they're not using their energy. They're using what is around them, conserving their energy. Even though they can reach altitudes of over 10,000 feet, they are usually soaring to these heights and take long glides to cover ground and then soar up again, repeating the process. So they keep going back to the higher heights. They keep going. They don't stay low. They keep going. Then let it carry them down. You think about all the other birds staying on a certain level, flapping to and fro. These eagles go high, and then they let it carry them. Their large wingspan allows them to glide and use very little energy. Average wingspan of 5 to 7. I've read another spot 7 to 9, but either way, that's wide. Number five. Eagles nurture their young. Eagles mate in the air. Eaglets are nesting for 10 to 12 weeks. By the time they're 9 weeks old, they're fully grown. Once the babies hatch, the female is present at the nest about 90% of the time. The male is present about 50% of the time. At least one of the parents is at the nest all the time. It is. A lot of them leave. You know, a lot of birds leave their babies and come back. But one of them will stay. He'll never leave us. You know, you're young. And when you think about these parents, you think about the Lord. He'll never leave you. Starting at day one, the young nestlings are directly fed raw meat. Eagles do not regurgitate food to feed their young like some other animals do. During the first 2 weeks of the baby's lives, the male provides most of the food. After 3 to 4 weeks, the female provides as much food as the male. By the late nesting period, the females provide most of the food. Eaglets are fed 1 to 8 times a day. Their parents carry prey to the nest. They feed their chicks by tearing off pieces of food and holding them out to the beaks of the eaglets. The parents tear off bits of flesh and feed them directly bill to bill. By age 5 weeks, the male and female parents bring nearly equal amount of foods to their chicks. Parents begin spending more time away from the young and often perch in nearby trees. By 6 weeks old, the young are able to stand and walk. By 7 weeks old, their maximum body growth is nearing completion. At 8 weeks, they are at their hungriest and ready to fly by week 12. At 9 weeks old, the chicks are fully grown. Chicks continue living in the nest and gaining strength for up to 12 weeks. So I was reading a little bit about that, and it says that I read a couple different things, but it says that the, you know, when the eagles are old enough, they will start to, well, let me read this first. Time to grow. That's my third point. When the eagles had eaglets and they have gotten to the age where they are going to start learning how to fly, the mother will dig up her nest, making it uncomfortable for the young so that they will start to want to leave the nest. Yeah, exactly. And if you jump back to your first page, in Deuteronomy 32 and 11, it says, "As an eagle stirreth up her nest, fluttering over her young, spreadeth abroad her wings, and taketh them, beareth them up on her wings." So that first part right there, the eagle will stir up her nest. She'll make it uncomfortable. And so that they will want to go. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Disperse. Mm-hmm. Right. Exactly. We as Christians, under the care of the Father, sometimes our nest has been dug up. Our situation is uncomfortable. Sometimes we ask God, why are we going through this period of our life? It's simple. God is trying to make you take a step. While other birds will push their young out, the eagle makes it uncomfortable so that the eaglet will go on their own. And they'll have the confidence to go, when they're ready, to go on their own. God is trying to make you take a step. You know, it would be just as easy, to, like other birds, to just push them out and see if they fly. You know, that's... But the eagle doesn't. They stir up that nest, just like it says in Deuteronomy. Stirring up that nest to make it uncomfortable. And I agree with Sister Powell talking about the disciples being dispersed, you know. God will stir up your nest to push you in a different direction. And sometimes we ask the Lord, why are you stirring my nest? But he's trying to do something in you. And just another verse I didn't hit on, but it's on your first page. In Deuteronomy 14 and 12, it says, "But these are they of which ye shall not eat, the eagle and the ophridge and the osprey." So in the, I did not know that this was in there, but the Bible says not to eat an eagle. I did not know that until I started studying this. So can't eat the eagle. So he is trying to stir some nests in people. Make it uncomfortable. The mother eagle wants the baby to do it on its own so he can learn his own strength. Is God stirring your nest today? What direction does he want you to go? We are like the baby eaglet when we get saved, when we first get saved. Our nest and our upbringing in the nest of the earth. But once we receive the nourishment from the Heavenly Father, we should grow. Just as an eaglet takes weeks to perfect his flight before trying on his own, we must go to our Father and learn of him and of his ways so we too can survive and take our heavenly flight. We have to learn, you know, and just like these baby eagles, they teach them how, you know, to eat. They teach them how to fly. They'll let them. I read one account that says that they will also build smaller nests within the tree so that the babies can jump, you know, just fly limb to limb and then have a place to stay if they can't make it back. So they make little provisions for the birds to kind of jump around and fly in the tree so that they're slowly learning how to fly. I think I had read it was, I want to say 3 to 5, I think it was. I didn't write it down, but that don't quote me on that, but it was a few. Number 4 point that I want to make about eagles is molting. During the year, the eagles lose their flight feathers. They will grow fresh and stronger feathers. This shows us that we need our strength and our strength renewed constantly. We don't get it all at once, but through our trials in life will come, and through time, we'll come with stronger feathers to face the next storm. So they shed their flying feathers constantly through the year, and then they'll grow back. It's usually a patch at a time. They usually won't lose them all at one time. But isn't that just like us when we go through the different things we go through? You might lose some feathers, but new ones grow back. So some people say the eagles are a bird that renews itself once a year, because basically if you go through the whole year as they're losing feathers, they do completely get their new wing flying feathers again. So it's like they're constantly renewing their flying feathers. Charlotte? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It is. Their human heart has less instinct than an animal. An animal will fight to the death for their young, but a human, some of them won't. They don't even care. It's unbelievable where the heart of man is. It really is. And that's what I say. Somebody, you know, this may seem like a very odd lesson. I take one scripture, Isaiah 40:31, but it says in there, and I'll read it again, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. So he compares us to eagles. So I want to learn about eagles. Anything the Lord has in the word, you know, people may think it's foolish, but I try to find something in everything. And if he says I'm like an eagle, then I need to read about how am I like an eagle and what does an eagle do that I need to do. That's just how I see it. So, yeah, they have absolute protection for their young, and they will fight to the death. And how much fight do we have sometimes? We give up easy. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. He is in everything. Yeah, they are his creation. He put them in his word for a reason. You know, just like in, I think a lot of times, this is totally off the subject, but when, you know, I kept seeing and hearing things about whales appearing. And then I went back and I'm like, well, are whales in the Bible? Yes, the word whale is in the Bible in the beginning. It says he created the whales. So that fascinated me. I didn't, you know, it's like sometimes you just stumble upon something. But every, you know, Jesus used parables. He used the things of the natural to explain. So anything he puts in here, I believe, you know. So it is a little bit of a different lesson, but I wanted to learn about eagles, and I think we have a lot to learn from eagles. So they do molt, so they're complete feathering for just their flight feathers. They will lose continually through the year, and so basically in a year's time, they've renewed all of their flying feathers. And so same thing for us as we go through storms. You know, you need to grow those stronger feathers back. You know, don't let it just completely take you. You know, learn something from it, move forward from it, you know, and then you'll grow back wings for the next storm. The wind of the Holy Ghost. And just as he blew on the day of Pentecost, I thought about this majestic eagle, and all I kept picturing is him soaring and going and using, like we said, using the wind to guide him. You know, he flies as high as any other, higher than any other bird. He catches that wind underneath his wings, and he lets it carry him. So just as that wind blows, and it blew on the day of Pentecost, the wind also takes the eagle in the sky. He is at ease in the wind. He rests in the wind and on the wind and uses it to glide. So the wind can come from any direction, just as the Holy Ghost moves in different ways. The eagle lets it carry him. So you think about wind, and you think about the day of Pentecost when the wind came in. That very wind, you know, carries the eagle, and we should rest in the Holy Ghost. And you will see it in different directions, and you know, but you just have to let it carry you. Zechariah 4:6 says, "Not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord." So what is God is trying to tell us in this verse is that all things will get fully accomplished for him in this life by the power of the Holy Spirit operating through us, not by our own power, by our own might. But just like the eagles has to learn how to fly in the wind thermals, we as born again, spirit-filled Christians have to learn how to fly on the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. That's the only way we're going to make it. In other words, we have to learn how to walk and to fly with the anointing of God. The anointing of God is the power of the Holy Spirit flowing and operating through us to accomplish what God wants us to do for him in this life. It is God's power flowing and operating through us, not our own power. Our power is weak and limited, but just like that eagle, he lets the power of the wind carry him. God's power is pure and absolute. What can we learn from the eagle? What have we learned? Have a vision. Have a vision for your life. Without it, you're going to perish. We have to soar high above the things of the earth. And I thought about that, you know, how the Bible says for us to be separate. And just like, you know, the eagle being up there in the air, he can look down and, like we said, 2 miles away, see a rabbit. He can look down and see what's real and what isn't. He can see through camouflage. He's keen. You know, we have to be the same way. And as we look upon this earth and the things coming upon this earth, we should be above it spiritually in our minds. We should be above it. We can't get tangled up on the things of the earth and what's going on around us. We have to be wise. We know that. We have to know what's going on to a degree. But I believe in this. It just seems like in this end time here that the things of this world are so consuming our minds that it's separating us from what we need to do. We're flying too low to see the things on the earth. We need to go up. We need to fly higher and get up higher. We have a vision for your life, have to soar high above the things of the earth. We have to grow in our Christian walk, forever molting as we go. Shedding the, you know, shake off them storms. Don't carry it with you. Don't hold angst against your brother or your sister if they've done something to you. Let it go. It's only holding you low. You got to go higher towards the sun. Just like I said, the eagle can look directly in the sun. He can fly directly towards the sun to confuse the osprey that try to catch him. That's what we have to do. Keep our eyes on the sun. Fly high in the wind of the Holy Ghost. Let the Holy Ghost carry you. If we do not have enough faith and belief in God to take flight on the Holy Spirit in order to be led and empowered by Him for service to the Lord, then nothing will ever happen. Actually, it will happen. You'll fall. That's right. I agree. If you know, you really, it can overtake you if you let it. And I think a lot of people do. They get so caught up in you know, the politics and the different things. And I understand, you know, I do. But I think all the effort and the time that you're putting into that, you know, if you would take that time and draw a little closer to the Lord and read your Bible, you know, it'll take you above all that. And it's not, and like I said, in the end, none of it's going to matter. And none of it's going to matter. It's all temporary. We got to be like the eagle, be close to the sun, stay flying close to the sun. We will forever stay perched. And we will never fulfill the destiny, divine destiny that God has for us. He has for our lives, even before we were born. Right. It's like, yeah, that old saying, you can't see the forest for the trees, you know. We're so preoccupied, and I'm guilty. I'm not pointing fingers at anybody. I work, you know, 10 hours a day, and sometimes that it's all I can do to come home and just get focused. You know, I'm so tired, and my sugar being high and this, I'm focused on that and trying to get to the, you know, there's a million things, and we can all say that. There's a million things going on in our lives, it seems like. And it just keeps us going and going and going. And I just, you know, all I kept picturing was just this eagle flying. Yes. It is. We shouldn't have, yeah, looking upon the things of the earth, you will tend to get fearful if you really think about it long enough. But if you trust in the Lord and keep your eyes on the Lord, it's all going to fade away. It ain't going to matter. You know, when we're up there in glory, we won't remember any of it. So if the eagle does not take flight on those wind thermals, when they do come upon him, he will stay forever perched, and he will die on the cliff due to starvation. So you got to take that plunge, or else you're going to just starve to death spiritually by just waiting. So what can we learn? What did we learn from the eagle vision? We learned the wind of the Holy, letting the wings carry you, the wind of the Holy Ghost, stays close to the sun. You know, I was reading an interesting thing too, and then I couldn't find it again, but I was reading how somewhere explained how they do, once the babies jump from limb to limb and learn how to fly, that they will take the baby, the eaglet, high, and they'll let it go. Now, one account said that they don't do that. One account said that they did, so I don't know. But it says that the male will take the eaglet up and it will let it go to see when it's ready, not right off the bat, once they've jumped a little bit limb to limb. And let him go and let him fall and see if he flaps his wings. And then if he does not, he swoops down and catches him, takes him back up, and does the same thing again. And it says they can repeat it anywhere from 4 to 15 times till that eaglet finally flaps its wings. And I thought about that, how, you know, sometimes it's seeming like we're just free falling. You know, when we're flapping our wings, we don't know, we're not gaining any momentum, we're just out there flapping, but he's always there to catch us. He's never going to leave you. He may take you up high, and he may let you go, and you may be flapping on your way down through that storm, but he will catch you. He's not going to let you hit the ground. Yeah, exactly. And so that is the comparison. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. And that verse says a whole lot. I am actually finished. If anybody has anything they'd like to add about the eagle, perfect timing. There's the bell. Sister Fleming. they said about the eagles that they take turns on them, so much so that they will get a bald spot on their bellies from where they're hovering over the so staying so long on the exit, they'll get a little bald spot on their belly. So it was really interesting, but yeah, be like the eagles. We gotta get our vision close. We gotta fly as high as we can to the sun and ride on the wings of the Holy Ghost. Let it direct you. Let it glide you through this life, and keep our eyes off of things of the earth. Sister Powell. Oh yes. Renewed like the eagles. Mm-hmm. Yeah. No. You should never get tired. Never get old. And like them molting their flying feathers, that should be constant renewal in the Lord. Genuine love, absolutely. And how much does he love us today? He sent his son for us, you know. So, all right, anybody else have anything they'd like to add? All right, Sister Jones, can you dismiss us in prayer, please?